I know what day it is. It's the 26th, Thursday, July 2012. The Olympics of 2012 start tomorrow, Friday. And that's very important right now for us to continue momentum, the momentum of inquiry, inquiring into unconditional love, true freedom, true safety, true happiness, truth itself. As we come up now on one of the major turning points of 2012, and indeed in history, it is truly bailout time for this world, time to bail out. Any time is a good time. By bailing out, we don't mean anything self-destructive at all, but to drop the attempt to embrace the world. Drop that attempt. We don't need to embrace the world. This Olympics will be an attempt to con everybody into tightening their embrace on the world, saying, isn't the world a wonderful place? Whereas we know that it is becoming a most terrible place. It's always been a most terrible place. Never more so than now, because the demand that we embrace it is becoming much, much more potent. The means by which to seduce us, induce us, and pressure us and punish us if we don't have become much more sophisticated, much more intense, much more all-encompassing. And that is why it is a most auspicious time to bail out on this entire scenario. The world has no brakes right now. It's gotten completely out of hand. The spirit of inquiry, the spirit of true self-interest, the spirit of truth, the spirit of compassion and forgiveness, all of those have been subsumed under the spirit of gain and greed and redistribution and equality and utopia and social justice and all these things, where the ends are held up to justify whatever means. In other words, the ends are seen as so all important that people simply don't even care about the means. You know, let's just get there by whatever means, and let's not even be reflective on what means we're using, because the ends so-called justifies the means. We're at that place now. We're at that place in the world where we're in this extreme time of fanaticism and activism and relativism and extreme forgetfulness of the goal, the purpose, how we can get true freedom, true salvation, true liberation. All of those things have been pulled under, as it were, and covered up by fakery. And so this the world celebration, what is the world celebrating? It's going down the tubes. Why celebrate that? Why not have an Olympics of inquiry, where all the different paths of inquiry can get together and showcase for the world just how important inquiry really is? Why not do that? Instead, we have these freaks of physicality doing whatever their special muscle coordination thing is, whatever that may be, and it doesn't really help anyone gain anything. What really would help gain is if the world were held up, the ideal of inquiry, spiritual inquiry. Who am I? Why am I here? Where did the world come from? What's the purpose of the world? Who authored the world? What authored the world? What purpose does the world serve? Et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, like that. What is truth? What are lies? What is true and what is not true? Questions such as that so many different questions and inquiry should be televised worldwide as the most important broadcasting ever. And yet, there's no chance of that right now, because we're all caught up in this so-called modern age, which is really a regressive age, the age of severe regression. It's not progress, we have regressed. We have regressed to an astonishing extent, to a frightful extent, which is why I say time to bail on the world. You know, at some point, you have to yourself reach freedom, decide for freedom. And you can't remain, you can do your best to witness to everyone, but if everyone, whoever chooses to remain on the path of spiritual arrogance, believing that they can find a way to change reality, then, you know, that's on them. It's not on those who sound the warning. I'm a watchdog, and a watchdog sounds the alarm and warns people of what's going on. But, you know, if there's an avalanche coming down and the watchdog is barking and warning everyone, and people choose not to listen, etc., the watchdog has every right to get out of the way of the avalanche, to run on down the road. It doesn't have to stay there and get buried along with those who don't heed the warnings. No, not necessary. So we really need to focus right now on realizing that the avalanche is about ready to take over the village. And we've sounded the warnings. Most of the time people would yell, "Shut up," to the barking dog. You know, nobody likes to hear a barking dog. But if I hear a barking dog in the neighborhood, I say, you know what? There's probably a good reason why the dog is barking. And instead of yelling, "Shut up," and kicking the dog and getting angry at the dog, say, "Dog, what's going on? What's going on with you? What's bothering you?" You know, something. A lot of times, those who sound the alarm, there's good reason for it. And there's been very good reason to sound the alarm during these times. It's extraordinary, shocking, chilling, what's taking place, how the world is being gripped in this horrible, mental state. Gosh, it's like a mental illness. It's like the whole world has become severely mentally ill. And of course, when you're mentally ill, you don't necessarily realize it. What you do is you project out on those who are not, and insist that they're the ones who are mentally ill. So therefore, you have what I call an inquisitional situation brewing in this world. The more mentally ill people become in this world, the more they are going to move towards scapegoating, trying to scapegoat onto those who are sane. The insane will project their insanity onto the sane and then attack it there, thinking that they're getting rid of their own insanity by doing that. That's how projection works. So those who are sane, time to bail out. Time to bail out. Really. Because basically, scapegoating doesn't do anyone any good at all. It's a lose-lose situation. The insane simply become more insane, thinking that they've found a way to get to protect themselves from insanity by projecting it outside of themselves and then attacking what they've projected it onto. That just strengthens madness. It doesn't help it at all. So it's really the duty of the sane to not accept scapegoating. Do not accept it. Because at the very least, that least allows the insane some room to have to focus on their insanity and realize that they're the ones suffering from it. And it's helpful for them, very helpful for them. At first, they might think that it's not, that it's punishing them. They might be angry, They say, there's nobody to project our insanity on. How terrible. Now I'm going to feel it myself. And they might feel very, very upset about that. But in the long run, eventually they realize, hey, I have to tackle this. It's not going away. Then they will make use of the assets and tools that they have to tackle this. So it's important. Do not put yourself in a position to be scapegoated in this time. Now, the spiritual path is easy to delineate. It's the discipline of seeing things in a totality, in a total way. It's instead of a set of parsing and dissecting and whittling down and detailing and trying to go through all that song and dance, that legalistic type of song and dance, struggling over definitions and everything. It's the big picture, spiritual path, big picture. All truth is true and lies will never be true. It's always the big picture. So that is the discipline. The discipline in this world has to be towards seeing the big picture of what can never be true, what must always be true, and what can never be true. That is it. So how many in the world are pursuing this path? And I don't see it. I don't see that path being pursued at all. People continuously speak in relativistic terms, which is ruinous. For it's not the spiritual path at all, it's the opposite. Speaking in relativistic terms. As if truth is just something that's relative to something else. Like it's all relative. There is no absolute truth, it's all just relative, as if that were so. It's not so. There is absolute truth. There is absolute truth. Truth is not relative to anything. Truth simply is true. That's it. That's all that it is. It's not truer than something else. It is 100% true. Truth is 100% true. If you want to ask yourself, how do we know we're on the spiritual path? If you can hear this and feel like, yes, and it just feels right, truth is 100% true. The sheer simplicity of it. If you love that, there's this sheer, unambiguous, stark, factual nature of it. The truth is true. The truth is 100% true. That's even better than saying truth is true. Truth is 100% true. And can never be otherwise. Can never be otherwise. Truth is 100% true and can never be otherwise. That is a powerful statement. If you want to know the spiritual path, truth is 100% true and can never be otherwise. Our truth is 100% true and it's impossible that it ever be otherwise. See, those are the kind of statements that the voice of reason within you will immediately recognize and say, yes, that's it. Just that. Nothing more than that. Don't add anything to it. Don't add or subtract anything to it. Just that. Truth is 100% true, and it's impossible that it ever be otherwise. And that's your antidote for the Olympics, right there. That's your antidote for this massive distraction from the spiritual path, realizing that it is 100% true and it's impossible that it ever be otherwise. You're not going to get any of that in the 3,500 hours of programming that are going to take place in the Olympics. You will never have that witnessed to in the slightest bit, not even once, which is certainly not surprising, because in all the teachings of the world, the classrooms, your job, your family, entertainment, wherever you go in this world, you will, every place other than true teachings of satsang or the teachings of an enlightened being, you will never, ever come across that teaching. It will never be emphasized for you. Truth is 100% true, and it's impossible that it ever be otherwise. You will simply not hear that, and you will wonder why. You won't even wonder why, because you never heard any. What's to wonder? Why even wonder? But if you do hear it, then you will ask yourself, how come I'm not hearing in other places? How come if I tune into the Olympics, am I going to hear this? That truth is 100% true, and it's impossible that it ever be otherwise. Am I going to hear that? Is that going to be the emphasis? Is that what the announcers are going to focus on? The commercials? Are the commercials going to emphasize that? And if not, then how well am I being served? That is the question. How well is anyone being served? If statements of fundamental truth are completely overlooked, you can say they're excluded, they're overlooked, how can that be, how can we be well served by that? That's the question. If we're not being reminded of our one responsibility, the world kind of acts like we've all got it. Everyone acts like, hey, no problem, I got it. And if someone says, well, do you have it now? They say, no, but any moment I can get it, it's not a problem. But it is a big problem when you delay it. That is the only problem there is. So if someone say, well, it's no problem, I can get it any time I want to. Ask them again in 10 years, same thing. And no problem, I can get it anytime I want to. Maybe that is a problem. Maybe that is a big problem. By simply choosing to delay, that's all that we choose is delay. Continually choose delay. And we always say, well, delay is not a problem because I can do it anytime I want to. There's the kicker. Anytime I want to. When are they going to want to? Right? That'd be the next question. Well, when do you want to do it? And I say, I don't know. Sometime. Very vague. Very vague. And when people die, you're sure, okay, now they're going to finally want to. Do they? No. No, they don't. They'll say, nah, I don't want to right now either. So we go through a life of time of not wanting to. Not wanting to. Yeah. And so that is the great obstacle. Not wanting to. Not yet. This ruins our lives. Not yet. Hang in there just a little longer and see what happens. This background kind of looks like the subtle world, you know, in a lot of ways. It's certainly something different than what we're used to seeing, isn't it? Yeah. We can probably see the subtle world by making some kind of adjustments to perception, like we're making adjustments here, and it's doing some pretty interesting things. Very interesting things, actually. We could probably do that with our perception and see subtle plays of various energies. Not that that is, has anything to do with awakening. It doesn't. There were times when people on this planet saw the subtle energies, had very different cultures, very different artistic expressions, because they were seeing differently than we do. They were seeing the energy patterns, which is, again, is not enlightenment. It's not realization. It has nothing to do with realization or enlightenment. Perception can be altered in various ways, but they're still just all meaningless. Meaningless. Now, a lot of people feel that the London Olympics are going to be quite strange. Of course, the advertisements, if that's anything to go on, they're going to be very strange indeed. You have to wonder what is going on with these people and the way that they've advertised it. Exactly what is their purpose here? Kind of like the murals in the Denver airport. I mean, what exactly are they aiming at there? Kind of strange. And London Olympics is very strange. No question about that. We'll find out sooner than later just what goes down there. In that very ancient city where a lot has gone down. And there may be a lot more to go. May see that during the Olympiad. Not that we'll be watching. I'm going to skip it as much as I possibly can. I'm going to provide broadcasts here as much as possible, and continue to stay focused on where we need to stay focused, which is on absolutes, the absolute of truth is 100% true, and it's impossible that ever be otherwise. Stay focused on that. You're not going to get that by watching the Olympics or by watching any television, as a matter of fact. There's never been a show on television that points this direction. What does that tell you? What does that tell you? It tells you it's a distraction. It's amazing how we waste time in this world. Absolutely amazing. We're great artists. Everyone's great artists in wasting time. We're stupendously gifted in that way, because that we must be, in order to continue the pretense that we can succeed. Existence can have a successful conclusion while we become prime creator. We have to believe in distraction, and we cannot pay any attention at all to truth. As soon as you start paying attention to truth, you begin a process of paying more attention to it. Not less, but more. You find out it's possible. As soon as you find out it's possible to pay attention to truth, then you're really going to start it up. Once you start it up, you won't be able to stop. Because you, well, knowing that there is an answer to suffering and misery, you won't want to give up. It's that simple. There's been a lot of speculation about the Olympic Games. About what is its purpose, what is going to happen, and we will simply wait and see. Will something very, very unusual, out of the ordinary happen? It wouldn't be a slight surprise if that were so. You know, history tends to seize the moment. And this certainly is a moment coming up. And there's a certain dynamic in existence that tends to be very audacious in seizing the moment. Even if it's like been foretold, and it would seem to be kind of a reckless thing, there's still a dynamic that impels some to seize the moment. Seize the moment. So it shouldn't come as a bizarre surprise to us if there are those in the world who use this as a means to try and leap on the stage. We can never underestimate the madness of those who suffer so terribly in this world. The burden of existence, those who suffer the burden of existence, it cannot be overemphasized just how shockingly difficult it is to carry that burden. And the desire to get free of that burden in some way ends up impelling history forward. History moves. History doesn't wait for anyone. It really doesn't. And when it's moving time in history, it moves. It gets moving. And it would be a shock if that didn't happen at the Olympics. But then again, you know, never. It's hard to know exactly how things will play out. Seems like we're looking here at just like a subtle realm of all these different transformations here. What could happen at the Olympics? Well, it's almost anything. Almost anything. do is to get off the stage altogether. To bail out on the stage. Bail out on the staging. Don't sit around waiting for something to happen to you. So that's another way of carpe diem, seizing the day, is seize the right time, the right moment to bail out on a collapsing scenario. The world can only double down so much. Can only live on half truths, which are really just lies. Can only do that so much. Can only continue a path that doesn't work for so long until the dead endness of it is realized. But even though we respect the intelligence and integrity of many who wish to remain with this scenario, we certainly aren't going to hold our breath for that someone to wake up. You know, we can showcase how important it is to wake up, but others won't necessarily do that, and we cannot just continually hold our breath for that to happen. They may go down with the ship. Most people are so blinded by ideology that they literally can't see the big picture. They cannot see the big picture. They only see with what their blinders allow them to see, which is their affiliations, their party, what do they belong to, and they see that as good, and everything else is terrible. Very provincial outlook we have. How about seeing everything in the world is awful? Really, it's all nothing. Instead of seeing what you've got is good and what other people don't have is good, or what everyone else has is good, but what you have isn't good. So these narrow partisan perspectives that the world has really gotten into, it is the greatest disaster possible in this world. To become narrowly partisan is the worst thing one can do. The worst. Remember, truth is 100% true, and it's impossible that it ever be otherwise. That is a statement of fact and of truth, not a statement of partisanship to some half-truth. And one engages in half-truths, partisanship really arises. That's the problem. The more the world swings towards politics instead of spiritual focus, the more partisanship arises, the more fanatical people become, because they can only see their very narrow, rigid, ideological perspective. Instead of having this panoramic perspective and seeing that, you know, all these different tribes are all mistaken. They're all just simply variations on the same theme. You don't need to be partisan to anything in particular here. But people have now believe their safety dwells in rigid ideological partisanship from all sides. And that is a disaster for the world. That's what causes conflicts. Projection onto others of your own inadequate clarity, and blaming then others for it, and attacking them, thinking you're getting rid of the source when the source is really within you. The desire to be prime creator gave rise to all of this trouble. So, the rise of partisanship is just enormous. It's crazy. It used to be a large middle ground of people who would listen to both sides, all sides, and make up their own mind of what they wanted. Nowadays, it's like considered blasphemy, you know, to consider anything other than what serves one's partisan interests. That's all important. So it doesn't other point of views don't matter to the world right now. But most people are stuck on one point of view. So they don't see the utilitarianism of satsang, of inquiry. They feel they already know the truth. They're right and everybody else is wrong. That's their truth. That's the big mistake. And we're head over heels with that situation right now in the world. It's as bad as it can get. Almost as bad as it can get. There's probably, you know, it can still deteriorate. It's kind of like when someone jumps off a cliff and you say, well, that's as bad as it can get. And then someone says, well, when they hit the ground, that's actually as bad as it can get. So it's kind of like that. When I say it's as bad as it can get, we've already jumped off the cliff. The world has already jumped off the cliff. It's already happened. And so I say, that's as bad as it can get. Well, that is, you know, that's accurate, because hitting the bottom is a given. It's a given. But someone else might say, well, yeah, you haven't really seen anything yet, because everything's still hanging together pretty good. Flying, you know, plummeting downwards, but nevertheless, some will say, well, you know, it's not that bad yet. And one who understands momentum and direction and all of that, they will say, well, yeah, it really is terrible. They are going to, you know, hit the bottom. It's guaranteed. So this one's headed towards the bottom, headed towards hitting the bottom. When it hits the bottom, that's when people will suddenly say, oh my gosh, this is terrible. But, you know, I have been saying, and many have been saying and listening for a long time, aware that of this jump and then hitting the bottom, been aware of it. So we don't have to wait until we hit the bottom here. Why do that? It's a given anyway. We should bail out on the situation. Bail ourselves out. We set this up, and now it's really causing us problems. So, most certainly the Prime Creator understands our situation, understands how to bail us out. It's a very doable scenario. Very doable. I don't know if I've been rambling here or not, but most likely I have, because I feel this sort of very tired, dazed condition. Barely awake. Keeps slipping in and out of extreme forgetfulness. That's the times that we live in. It's the times that we live in. And we don't have to hit the bottom. We do not. The Prime Creator understands that the world has jumped already. And so it's now just a bailout situation. You know, pull the parachute. It's a pull the parachute time right now. Don't, you know, if we wait to pull the parachute until we hit the bottom, it's too late at that point, right? It's too late. It seems like the people of the world trying to be fakely wise are trying to play it cool and saying, you know, like, it's not time to pull the parachute. Everything's still pretty... Too premature. Don't be panicky here. As if they're got it all under control and they're really strong-minded and they don't indulge in fear. They say, oh, fear's a bad thing. Let's not indulge in it. Let's keep believing. Well, meanwhile, the body, social body, is plummeting down towards the bottom of this abyss. And it is very important to fear the consequences of that. And to react to that fear and saying, hey, you know, time for a bailout. That's being very responsible and wise. It's either that or wait till it hits bottom, and then by that time it's too late. So either one does it in a timely fashion, which is right now, or one is going to be too late. And being too late is just complete failure. You know, worse than that, it's an avoidable failure. is a failure that could have been a hit. And that's really, that's doubly tragic. Very cool this evening, very cool indeed. So, we don't want to wait until we hit bottom before we pull our parachute, because when you hit bottom, too late to pull the parachute. So those who pull the parachutes, how can they be judged as, oh, you panicked. If you just held in there a little while longer, you'd have been better. No. If we hang in there a little while longer without pulling our parachutes, it's going to be too late. It's going to be too late. And that's just absolutely compounding imbecility. It's like we're so used to imbecility, we protect it. And we think that it has some kind of wisdom for us. Like it says, don't pull the parachute prematurely. You know, like we think, oh, that's a great wisdom. What's prematurely? If you've jumped over into the abyss, what is prematurely pulling a parachute? What does that really mean? Either pull it now or pull it later. It's just as good. Still, you know, do we really have to continue to go through some kind of horrendous plunge? Says who? That's the question. Do we really have to hit bottom? By then it's too late. So, time to pull the parachute cord. Time to pull the parachute cord. Absolutely. That must be done. Right now. Cannot wait. Continue to wait. That's the ego's plan. Just wait. Don't ever pull that parachute cord. It counsels us that way. Don't pull the parachute cord. Just keep waiting. Which is the worst advice possible. The worst advice possible. I'd say it's time to pull the parachute cord. It is time. It is time. Waiting is futile. Waiting gets us nowhere. We learn nothing by plummeting into the abyss of history. We learn nothing from that. Still, even when I'm about 95% asleep, the only thing, I'm barely able to talk, I'm still able to say what's important is the truth is 100% true, and it's impossible that ever be otherwise, and pull the parachute cord now, bail out now, pull the cord now. No reason to wait. Waiting only brings us that much closer to impacting the bottom. At full speed, we don't want to do that. So, can still remember these things, even in a very feeble condition. Though it's not too difficult. Boy, okay. We're going to wrap this up. I wonder how this audio is going to sound. I'm using a new microphone. And so we'll see how that goes. Remember, pull the cord now, very great, that's it for this video.